Rolling, 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 rolling,
yeah! Rolling, 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 rolling. Hello, welcome to Soiloid Mirror. I'm your hostess, Betty St. Laveau. On this show, we talk about film, film definitions, and film history. This is the month of May, so I want to touch lightly on the fact that we talked about Hollywood and psychotic mother in films. And I have a list right here consisting of the five movies that are the top psycho mom movie. All right, so partly why I formed this list was looking at the excellent The Act with Patricia Arquette, Chloe Sevigny, Juliette Lewis, and Sophia Robb. I can't remember the name of the little psycho killer who is in the movie, the actress, but she did a great job. So because of this particular miniseries, I formed this list. Marnie, Tippi Hedren, Sean Connery, Diane Baker, and the actor who played Alfred in the Batman series with Adam West. Great, great movie, and I cannot remember the name of the actress who played the mom. Marnie's problems, the role excellently played by Tippi Hedren, stem from secrets that her mother has either shielded from her or at times hinted or alluded to. Check it out. And Sean Connery plays a son of a biscuit eater trying to get Marnie to tell up her secrets, okay? Next is Queen Margot. Isabel Anjani, Verna Lisi. Male actors' names elude me for a hot second. Jean-Claude Langvalde, who played the boyfriend La Femme Nikita. This movie is great, and actually, Queen Margot is based on a true story. It is the tale of Catherine de' Medici and her progeny back in 1572 France. And I made a mistake several weeks ago saying that 50 years had elapsed between one revolution and another. The date was 1572 when St. Bartholomew's massacre went down. A lot of historians and eyewitnesses blame Catherine de Medici for what occurred. But when you look at Werner Lisi's riveting role, how she played Catherine in this movie, the chills will go up your spine and down them, okay? Next is I, Tonya, another inspirational movie that made me think of May Queen, and Psycho Mothers. Allison Janney knocked it out of the park with this one. Kudos to her. What a great actress. Again, the actors and actresses who hone their art consistently, especially doing television, theater, not just movies, are our brightest stars. All right? What a great actress. Carrie, Piper Laurie, and Sissy Spacek getting down. Piper Laurie is almost funny in this one, and because she's hamming it up and she's doing a great job, and it's just a little bit below over the top. There are times when I'm watching Piper get down and get funky in this one, and I do laugh, but again, like Werner Lisi's role, very chilling, excellently portrayed. And then a movie that I will never see, but I want to get that out there, is Precious. The first time I saw this trailer, I jumped up and started cursing the television set, just like my mom did when she saw Gerard Depardieu in the trailer for Columbus 1492. Ma was mad, okay? I jumped right up and I said to the boyfriend, do we really need to see a movie about two disenfranchised fat black women? What else isn't there anything else? Okay, but I know that Monique got the Oscar for that and that she did a really a great job. Okay, so I think that'll wrap it up for for our psychotic mom thing. I also just wanted to use the title again. I love my mom a lot, and because of Ma, I'm in front of you talking about movies. She really instilled for me a love of movies. Thanks, Ma. Okay, so next, because of Mom, I want to do a movie that she really liked, but first, I want to talk about some of these crazy trailers I've been checking out. Incredible. I just can't believe what I'm watching, and I hope I have that list. Here we go. Okay, they're all horror movies. Where do they get these ideas and how do they get greenlit? All right, so the first one that started all off was Get Out, Jordan Peele's movie. Now, that movie should have been a lot more scary. I wanted more meat on that bone. It was a good movie. It wasn't half as scary. It got gory. I wanted more to the story. You know, it just can't be all about the sex, right? So that particular trailer was one of the first I'd seen in a long time that kind of scared me, okay? Then the next trailer that I saw after that, and we talked about it on the show, is Prodigy, about that little kid who's really smart. I jumped out of my skin when his mama goes, "Come here." And he goes, "I'm scared." And as he runs towards her because he's scared, and he turns into a full-grown man. Now, excuse me, you all were scared at that. That was like something out of The Exorcist, all right? Great, great, great trailer. The next scary trailer that I saw after that was Us. I don't know if I'm going to see this movie. I think it's about a doppelganger family. Look, I like twins myself, okay? But the trailer was so bloody, and they kept playing it over again, I started to get a little bit turned off. But great, frightening trailer, and I'll probably check it out in a year or two. The next trailer that I've been checking out, which is, it's funny that it popped up on the screen while I was doing the YouTube thing, because I was looking at Lupita, and I think I talked about this last time. So gorgeous, so gorgeous. I'm like, where's Octavia? Where's Taraj? And then Octavia Spencer is in a movie called Ma. And I guess these teenagers want to have her buy some beer, and she goes, "Come over to my house." And then in the trailer, one of the parents go, "How come you always hang out at Ma's?" Which, my sisters and I, we weren't really allowed to go out and about. We went to high school in Hanover, New Hampshire. We weren't really allowed to go out, but our friends can come over and visit us. Same for my brothers. So we would never have been allowed to hang out. We actually would have been allowed to hang out someplace called Ma's because it sounds innocent, right? This movie looks not innocent at all. The last trailer I'd like to talk about is this movie. It's this movie called Midsommar. Now, I just saw the trailer yesterday, and it goes like this. This girlfriend, she looks like she's a little clingy. And she's saying something to her boyfriend, and her boyfriend's like, "Yeah, whatever, I gotta go out with the guys." And I guess he's sitting around the table with the guys, and she texts him. And one of his friends goes, "Oh, is that her?" So I was going to stop watching the trailer. I'm like, oh, this is some Lifetime for male, jealous girlfriend thing, whatever. You know. Not, also, they look a lot younger, generationally. Didn't seem like my cup of tea. And then, as I keep paying attention to it, this guy is saying to the girl, "I'm sorry that happened." You watch her go in the bathroom, and then you see her in a car with a bunch of guys. I'm like, oh, look kind of interesting. And then the next thing I know, they're like in Sweden, and that's the land of Girl with a Dragon Tattoo and all those Bruce Weber, Calvin Klein ads. And they walk, I guess there's a flowered gate, and all these people are dressed in white, and it looks like a cult. I'm in, all right? And I'm thinking, no, the trailer just looks interesting to catch my eye, but it's called Midsommar, and it looks like a festival, and it looks like a bunch of freaks in Sweden. I'm there, okay? So I'm going to check that out. What I'd like to mention is that with all of these trailers, they usually, Hollywood will give the meat on the bone. The plots can be disappointing. Hopefully, Ma and Midsommar will deliver I'm sure Prodigy will too. Us looks a little bit gory, and Get Out was fine, but I wanted more to it. So there we have it with that. I think I have one more trailer here somewhere that I want to talk about. I think that's it. Okay, so I actually have a couple lists, and I can't remember if I talked about them recently, but there are some icons in Hollywood that I helplessly like, and then there are some icons that leave me cold. And I think a lot of us have that same feeling. Sometimes what our friends like doesn't mean that we're going to like it. So some of the icons that leave me cold are Stanley Kubrick. I'll never get him. Never in a million years. He's annoying and depressing. Some of his movies, I loved Clockwork Orange, but not because he directed it. And I love Barry Lyndon. His lighting is consistent. His staging is the same. The same setup in Barry Lyndon is the same setup in Clockwork Orange. Looks like a stage set, very static, not interesting, but I just never could warm up to his directorial skills. Peter Sellers also leaves me cold. I don't find him funny. I don't find him talented, boring, yawn. All respect to the dead. I don't get it, and I will never get it, and I love British people. Nope, just not my cup of tea. Annoying, over the top. Dr. Strangelove and Lolita, he was particularly repulsive. Just have to say it. Now, Dennis Hopper, you can tell the guy's scary. Can't warm up to that. Michael Bay, I don't care what Megan Fox said about him. I can't get through any of his movies. They're corny. And when I heard Mark Wahlberg and Transformers say, "You're grounded forever," that was it for me. All right? You can do better directing that, Mr. Bay. And I'll never direct your type of movie. You're very lucky that you can get the Army out, the Navy out, and planes and all that, but not a lot going on. Jimmy Stewart as Chuckles the Clown in Greatest Story Ever Told, no. Fred Astaire, even though I liked him as a kid. Diana Ross, no. Pauline Kael, I was Paulette as a teenager. I'm always going to tell the truth about a movie, and I will never. I know that she did. She kissed up to directors and wanted to boss them around about what to do, and I would never do that as a film critic. Are you kidding? Those producers will chop you up. The directors might listen to you, but the producers will chop you up, and the studio heads will too. So, film people who comment on film are good for that, but don't be bossing a director around. Now, the icons I helplessly like are Eric Roberts. Are you kidding? He is a genius. He's genius, genius, genius. Mads Mikkelsen, he's downright scary and talented. Totally. Helplessly like him. Mia Farrow is a saint. She's adorable. I'll believe anything that she says, sorry. Just like Paul Mooney says. Mia, and a great actress, all right? She's got it. William Holden, yes, no problem. Ma said, oh, he can't act. I said something like Sunset Boulevard. And she goes, oh, he was playing himself. But he played himself really well. And Picnic, too, excellent, dear to my heart. Gina Gershon, all day, all night. I love her. She's funny, sexy, chic, never will go out of style. Love your hair, Gina. You rock. And last but not least, Chael Sonnen. Even though he's not in the movies, Chael should be, okay? So there's my list of leaves me cold and helplessly like. And it's kind of, I didn't want to be negative, but sometimes you're talking with your pals and you notice that the things that excite them don't excite you. It's just good to let everybody know. Okay, so now we're going to do the, let's see, I already talked about Midsummer. I think we've got, and I'll save this list for later. I've got a great best credits, Screen Goddesses, best movies ever. We'll save that until next episode, I think. That's a pretty mighty good list. So we've got one documentary, two movies. The first movie I'm going to hit on is this great one called Seattle is Dying. I did not write down the director's name. You can catch it on YouTube. I watched it once. The first time was hard. Please watch it again. Basically, what is happening in Seattle right now is akin to a post-apocalyptic landscape. And that's a quote by Richard Patton. This has been going on for the last 5 or 10 years. He says, Seattle looks like caca, okay? It's not the Emerald City. It looks like the Third World. The Seattle police are afraid to speak out. They do not want to lose their jobs. They're not keeping the criminals in jail. And it's called Freeattle because a lot of people from different states are taking advantage of Seattle's, I think, free health care, free water, maybe free cigarettes. There's a lot that Seattle is giving out that people are becoming parasites because of it. When I watched this documentary, I saw that it was Tent City. And it's a cautionary tale about, I think, law enforcement. The police are dealing with mentally ill, who are also criminals, and their hands are tied by the courts. In one scene, the mayor, she happened to be a woman, she was smiling at the person who was obviously irate addressing her, and she said, if you've got a problem with the crime in Seattle, call 911. And this woman said to her, how dare you talk to us like that? And then other people started talking. So there's some undercurrents that I don't understand with the politics that are going on that is making Seattle look underdeveloped and something akin to the homeless population in LA, all right? So when you have buildings that are not finished, when you have buildings that are condemned, and when you have communities that aren't supporting urban renewal, you are dealing with broken down streets, weeds, not just the undergrowth of nature, but the breakdown of civilization. Not to sound corny. Great documentary. I loved every single minute of it. At one point, they interviewed one man who, his name's Travis Berg, and he came from Reno to Seattle about 4 years ago, and he was glad to be interviewed. He said, I like the meth, I love it. Oh, I've been arrested how many times? Assault, attempted rape, which one am I? He's a psychopath, and he's smiling into the camera, so I think that maybe there's a mental health issue going on too with the criminality. Anyway, one man, Todd Webke, said, we're running a concentration camp with weapons and drugs, swinging machetes and holding an axe. The guy's upset. He said, people are walking around doing whatever they want, it's like anarchy. It's too bad because the West, which is where all the Easterners wanted to get to because it was pristine a paradise, can also become filled with problems because people will take advantage of it. Anyway, please check out this movie. It opened my eyes about the West. I'm very attracted to Southern California, and it's making me think twice about not just LA, but city management and good neighbor and good community. All right. A little bit of a dreary documentary, but you're gonna love it. Entertaining, educationally entertaining. Okay, so the next movie we're going to do is, we're gonna do Moms First. I watched Under Siege this past Mom's Day because I'd loaned to my nephew Jack, not Out for Justice, the other one, where it's set in Chicago, the one with Pam Grier and all the cops in it. I usually like, and Sharon Stone. I just like to watch that one Mother's Day. So since I loaned that one, I watched Under Siege instead, which she sat me down for. This one is great. It's got Patrick Neal, Gary Busey, Tommy Lee Jones, and Cole Meany about to take over America and step into Michael Caine's shoes as the bad guy jobber, all right? Even though Michael Caine doesn't usually play the bad guy, but Michael Caine's in everything. And after this movie, Under Siege, Cole Meany, I saw him everywhere. He was even in Con Air, okay? What a great working actor, all right? So Elena Eneliak is also in it. I think that she was a Baywatch babe. Don't know that for sure. She plays Judson Tate, Miss June or July or something, and she's lucky she didn't end up on the cutting room floor. They gave her the worst lines, all right? So this is Steven Seagal as a petty cook, but he really has what Patrick Neal said, if I had your ribbons, I'd go to bed with them, all right? So Gary Busey plays a jealous commandant of the ship, and Tommy Lee Jones is the rogue CIA agent. Now, these two guys, again, started out in television back in the day, in the 70s when I was a kid. And I think Tommy Lee Jones was the original. He was the OG from Rich Man, Poor Man. I might be wrong. No, that was Nick Nolte. Anyway, same crew, same crowd, all right? Gary Busey, Buddy Holly story, all right? So at first, oh, pardon me, Tommy's playing a clown. And then he acts like he's playing a clown, musician, harmonica, all that. And then you see that he is evil as a day is long. And scenes with Steven Seagal, Gary Busey, he's playing the heavy. But Gary Busey's going like this. He's like staring at him, like he's really hating him. And Mom and I love Gary Busey. I mean, I really love that Gary Busey, right? And so I'm studying him this past weekend. I'm like, wow, he looks like he has a hate on for Sensei. Well, if Ma and I knew then what we know now about Mr. Sensei, Steven Seagal, I think a lot of his martial arts credentials are a little overblown. And the reason why he got put on in Hollywood is because he was Mike Ovitz's sensei. Mike Ovitz was the head and one of the founders of Creative Artists Agency, CAA, back in the day. So in Hollywood, at times, it really is who you know. As I studied Mr. Busey, this is my man Angelo from Point Break. This is the dude from Carney playing Robbie Robertson's best friend. Gary Busey can act. And I'm thinking that, you know, maybe he kind of knew that Steve was sort of a big old ham. But back in the day, Steven Seagal really rocked the house. He had the ponytail, he had the moves. He does run a little bit funny, but if it weren't for my MMA guys talking about that, I probably wouldn't notice it. At any rate, this is a great 90s flick, and if Ma was around right now, I think that she would say to me, oh, I don't like him anymore either now that he's cut his hair, okay? So I can kind of feel that coming on. All right, okay, Under Siege, check it out. I want to say that's 1996, I don't know. But at this point, it's vintage, pretty much. Okay, so the last movie we're going to talk about, and I've got the feeling I talked about this the last episode, but I'm not sure, is River's Edge. Crispin Glover, Keanu Reeves, Ione Skye, it was a lot of people's breakout roles. Dennis Hopper is in it, playing Dennis Hopper. You know, it's hard, you know, when you know that someone's just mean to everyone. Look, I read the book, all right? It's the read, to quote Mr. Mooney, okay? And I guess not everyone's a Jack Lord, and not everyone's a Paul Newman, and there's gotta be a Dennis Hopper somewhere, but not a great actor, not a great person, but all respect to his family, not into it, okay? So I read about this movie when it first came out, I want to see it. It's based on a true story. Gal is murdered, and the friends, for days, hang out by the body and talk and party, okay? Very disturbing. And I think it happened out in the Pacific Northwest, so I'm not positive. It was everybody's breakout role. Anybody who'd been in the movie, it was like everyone's first big movie. Watching it made me uncomfortable. It was like a snuff film disguised as entertainment. I didn't like it per se. It doesn't help that Dennis was there like a bad fairy at the christening. Why did he have to be in the movie? Unless there was someone like that. And it didn't help that he gets knocked out like a punk by some 11-year-olds later. Just, no, not good. Not a good look. So Crispin Glover, he overreacts throughout the whole movie. Pretty much plays a manic loser. The young actor playing Keanu's brother, is the kid's a demon seed. Great actor, all right? Movie is beyond violent. From what I remember, the bad script, horrible acting by Glover. I actually was horrified that I forgot that Dennis was in the movie. If I had remembered that Dennis was in the movie, I might not have checked it out. I'm just saying. But I'm glad I watched it. I'm thinking I must have watched it at least once. And it had been so long ago, and I don't think I watched it all the way through. And then watching it again, I kind of wish it never been made. Sorry, there's nothing funny about crime and punishment. But it appears that on television, it's a very, it's a source of entertainment, and it has been ever since sitcoms have bit the dust, Norman Lear time. So I'm thinking that's just about it for me today. I'm your hostess, Betty St. Laville. I hope you've enjoyed this episode of Soleroid Mirror. A little bit on the grim side, but May, we're still at the cutting edge of winter going into spring. So it's good to have a little, not so much decay, but it's good to like mix it up a little bit, not always be like romantic and cheery, okay? Until next time, darlings, take care of yourselves. I'd like to thank Gendron Building for its continued support. Also Kellogg Hubbard Library for helping me out with a lot of this material. If I forgot to cite my sources today, I do apologize for that. Maybe I'll get to it the next episode. Until then, stay away from those bad movies, babes. Ciao.